Join the party. This is our musical theater workshop performance, and I'm Alan Gamble, and this is Martha Peabody, right over here, and we are the two instructors here for this particular workshop. This is our third workshop, so we're very excited. They have come a long way again. As any of you who have done it before know, the whole process, we sort of, we take you through sort of a whirlwind tour of what it's like to be in a musical. And it consists of learning your dialogue, learning your songs, learning a little bit of movement, and vocal warm-up exercises, acting exercises, all kinds of things like that. So it's kind of a crash course in what it's like to actually be in a musical. And then it, of course, finishes with a performance, because you have to have a performance. You can't go to all that work and then not get to present it in front of your peers. So we are here to do that. And Martha, do you have anything that you would like to add?
Well, one thing that we really like to focus on, particularly at the beginning of each of the classes, is the use of the body for the singing. Because singing is a great part of musical theater, as you all know. And it means using that body athletically and using the breath. And so we spend a good part of time, certainly an hour, working on breathing, articulating, and using the voice. And that's just as much important as it forms into the entire choreography and the acting.
Right, because a lot of the people that take this workshop, the first thing they say is, oh, I can't do that, I can't sing. And this disproves all of that, because you don't have to be a great opera star to perform in musical theater. There are many wonderful character roles and acting, and Martha also helps everybody learn how to use their voice in a much better way. So it all works out, and it's really a lot of fun, and everybody learns that yes, they can sing and they can do musical theater. So it's a great transformation and kind of a step out of the box for a lot of people who just acted before, and then they jump out there and decide they're going to sing. So our first number is a production number. We like to incorporate everybody into the opening number. And we would like to welcome you this evening to this workshop's performance with a number from Cabaret.
Tell everybody to turn off their phones.
Yes, please do turn off your phones, all your little ringy-dingy things. All your little ringy-dingy things. All the things that whir and buzz and play music and dance. And
okay.
As I said, the first number is from Cabaret, and Cabaret is a musical with a book by Joe Masterhoff, music by John Kander, and lyrics by Fred Ebb. It was the 1966 Broadway production, became a hit, and it spawned a 1972 film as well as numerous subsequent productions. It's based on John Van Druten's 1951 play, I Am a Camera, which in turn was adapted from a novel, Goodbye to Berlin, by Christopher Isherwood. It was set in 1931 Berlin as the Nazis are rising to power, and it focuses on the nightlife at a very decadent club, the Kit Kat Club. So we would like to open our show this evening with Willkommen, featuring Joe Berardi as our MC, and Arlene Barnard, Ashley Plant, Minori Ishikawa, and Claire Maines as the Kit Kat Girls.
Willkommen, bienvenue, welcome, Fremde, étranger, stranger, Glücklich zu sehen, je suis enchanté, happy to see you.
Several couples and romantic triangles. And its title is a literal English translation of the German name for Mozart's Serenade number 13 for strings in G minor, Eine kleine Nachtmusik. In this scene, Desiree has discovered that her best laid plan of rescuing her longtime lover, Frederick, from his midlife crisis and his child bride may not work after all. So please welcome Claire Maines as Desiree Arnville.
Oh, Frederick, what were we laughing about? Your son was right at dinner. We don't fool him, not for one moment. The one and only Desiree Arnfeld, driving around the country in shoddy tours, carrying on with someone else's dim-witted husband, and the great lawyer Egerman, so busy renewing his unrenewable youth. Shall I tell you why I really invited you here? When we met again and made love, I thought, maybe this is it. Our chance to turn back, to finally sort out some kind of coherent existence after so many years of muddle. Of course, there's your wife. I thought, perhaps, just perhaps, you might need to be rescued too. It was just a thought. Sure of my life.
Blight. They are co-workers at Mushnick's Skid Row Florists, a rundown flower shop owned and operated by the cranky Mr. Mushnick. Seymour has recently obtained a mysterious plant that looks large, like a large Venus flytrap. During a sudden eclipse of the sun, the plant secretly develops special powers derived from feeding on human blood. Seymour is secretly in love with Audrey and names the plant Audrey II in her honor. The musical is based on a low-budget 1960 dark comedy film, The Little Shop of Horrors, directed by Roger Corman. We present Ashley Plant as Audrey.
I know Seymour's the greatest, but I'm dating a semi-sadist. So I got a black guy, my arms are cast. Still, that Seymour's a cutie. Well, if not, he's got in a beauty, and I dream of a place where we can be together at last.
What kind of place is that, honey? An emergency room?
Oh, no. It's just a daydream of mine. A little development I dream of just off the interstate. Not fancy like Levittown. Just a little suburb. Far, far from urban Skid Row. Oh, I dream of it all the time. Just me and a toaster and a sweet little guy like Seymour. A matchbox of a room, a fence of real cheap.
Trapped house that we share.
is Maine. This musical is booked by Jerome Lawrence and Robert Edwin Lee, and music and lyrics by Jerry Herman. Originally titled My Best Girl, it is based on the 1955 novel Auntie Maine by Patrick Dennis, and a 1956 Broadway play by Lawrence and Lee that had starred Rosalind Russell. It's set in New York and spans the Great Depression, World War II, and focuses on an eccentric bohemian, Mame Dennis, whose famous motto is, "Life is a banquet, and most poor suckers are starving." Her fabulous life with her wealthy friends is interrupted when her young son, when the young son of her late brother arrives to live with her. As a child, she raises Patrick with much love and much freedom amidst her colorful life and friends, but he's eventually taken off to boarding school and placed under the influence of the rather stuffy executor of their estate. In this particular scene, Patrick arrives home unannounced for a surprise visit, and he is very much changed. And we present Arlene Barnard as Maine and Joe Berardi as Patrick. Woo!
Auntie Maine?
Why, Patrick, what are you doing home from school?
I had something very important I wanted to talk with you about. But if you...
Book!
I bet that's going to be some book. Auntie Maine, I was wondering if I could talk with you a little bit. Alone. It's rather personal and rather important.
Why, of course, my dear. Brian is upstairs in his room.
His room? Is he living here?
Why, of course, darling. I mean, there was nobody in the sculpture room, and we are literally working together day and night, so to speak.
Very cozy.
Why, for a minute there, you sounded like somebody from the Knickerbocker Bank.
Please get O'Banion out of here right away.
I beg your pardon?
I don't want him in this house.
Aren't you taking a rather imperious tone? I mean, Mr. O'Banion is my colleague.
Colleague, my foot. Gloria would never understand you and this Irish phony are...
Gloria? Who's Gloria?
Auntie Maine, listen to me. I've met a girl. I've been going with her for several months.
Oh?
She's a very special girl. I guess I should have told you about her before, but I knew you were all tied up with your book and everything. And until now, it wasn't even really definite.
Well, what's definite now?
Gloria's the girl. That's what's definite. And you're going to meet her tonight.
Well, I hope you didn't leave her sitting in the car.
I dropped her off at her girlfriend's, Bunny Bixler's on Park Avenue. She wanted to get spruced up before she met you.
Oh, well, I gotta do some sprucing up of my own.
I'll bring Gloria back in about 10 or 15 minutes, okay?
I'll have my face all organized.
But wait a minute. If O'Banion's still here, I'm not bringing Gloria back. Gloria happens to be a very sensitive and well-brought-up girl, and I don't want you flaunting your new flames and old peccadillos in front of her.
Then why bring her here at all?
Do you want to know the truth? I've been trying to avoid it, but she really wants to meet you.
So you just dropped by to see if I was all scrubbed up and presentable and ready for inspection, is that it?
Now, Auntie May, for just 5 minutes tonight, will you try to act like a normal human being? Then I will stop making demands on you. Gloria comes from good stock, and she just doesn't need to know about all your airy fairy friends from Fire Island or your Irish friend upstairs. I'd just rather that my little Gloria didn't have to know about a lot of things that ordinary mortals simply don't have to know about.
Should she know that I think that you have turned into the one of the most beastly, bourgeois, little bippity little snobs on the Eastern Seaboard? Or will you make that perfectly clear without any help from me?
All right, forget about the whole thing.
Patrick! Bring your girl here. I won't let her have the wrong impression. I promise.
Thanks, Hunty. You're top drawer. Really, top drawer.
Why did I buy him those damn long pants?
Pacific, which is a 1949 musical with music by Richard Rodgers, lyrics by Oscar Hammerstein II, and the book by Hammerstein and Joshua Logan. The story draws from James A. Mitchener's Pulitzer Prize-winning 1947 book, Tales of the South Pacific, weaving together characters and elements from several of its stories. The musical won the Pulitzer Prize for Drama in 1950. The issue of racial prejudice was sensitively and candidly explored at a time when few musicals engaged in serious social commentary. This scene features a colorful, middle-aged, Tonkinese seller of grass skirts, nicknamed Bloody Mary, and U.S. Marine Lieutenant Joseph Cable, who has just arrived on the island from Guadalcanal. Bloody Mary sees special qualities in him and decides he would be perfect for her niece, Liette. Bloody Mary tries to persuade him to go to Bally High, as she mysteriously says that it is his special island. Please welcome Minori Ishikawa as Bloody Mary, Joe Berardi as Lieutenant Cable, Claire Manis, Ashley Plant, and Arlene Barnett as the nurses.
Intriguing little island, isn't it, Lieutenant? You know, officers can take out mortgages and go over there for a ride.
Bally High. What does that mean?
Bally High means I am your special island. It's me. Here I am. Bally High. Your special island, Lieutenant. I know. You listen. You hear. I am called to you. Listen. You know hear something? You hear voice. Most people live on a lonely island. Bye.
to New York. Okay? Our last scene is from West Side Story. West Side Story is an American musical with a script by Arthur Lawrence, music by Leonard Bernstein, lyrics by Stephen Sondheim, and the fabulous choreography of Jerome Robbins. The musical's plot and story are based on William Shakespeare's Romeo and Juliet. It's set in New York City in the mid-1950s. The musical explores the rivalry between the Jets and the Sharks, two teenage street gangs of different ethnic backgrounds. The members of the Sharks are from Puerto Rico and are taunted by the Jets, a white working class group. The young protagonist, Tony, one of the Jets, falls in love with Maria, the sister of Bernardo, the leader of the Sharks. The dark theme and sophisticated music focus on social problems, making a turning point in American musical theater. We would like to present in this beautiful, beautiful balcony scene, Ashley Plant as Maria and Joe Berardi as Tony.
Only you, you're the only thing.
Tomorrow.
Yes, I work at the bridal shop.
At sundown.